Our next panel, as we start, Hope Bohanec is the author of the book, The Ultimate Betrayal. Will Tuttle is the book author of the book, The World Peace Diet. And David Simon is the author of the book, Meatonomics. And our topic that we are talking about is where your food comes from. So factory farms, the truth about where your food comes from. So the first question I guess I'd like to ask is, are we supposed to talk about this? This seems like a topic that doesn't come up that much around the dinner table. Friends don't encourage me to go into detail. Are we supposed to avoid this, smile and say everything is, don't worry about it, I'm sure it's fine? I mean, are we supposed to have this conversation, or should we, are we supposed to even talk about it in public? What's your thought?
Yeah, I think that, you know, the problem, of course, is that we live in a society where people would much rather not think about the violence to animals that is occurring because of their choice to eat animal-sourced foods. And that's why it's very important for us, I think, to talk about it and to bring this message to the world. In some ways, there's this great quote attributed to, I mean, something that Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote. He said, "People long to be settled. Only to the degree that they are unsettled is there any hope for them." And I think, so I think in some ways, I think, at least from myself anyway, I see my job as upsetting people and, you know, making people uncomfortable. And I don't, you know, I don't like to do that necessarily, but I think that the enormous amount of violence towards animals, the abuse of ecosystems, the suffering that's being caused, as well as the enormous opportunity that we have to transform our society requires us to bring this message to people. So I think the question really is how we do it, how we bring this message, how much depth can we bring to the message, and also, of course, from my point of view, it's very important to be a spokesperson for the animals who really don't have a spokesperson if we don't speak up for them, and to speak in ways that people can hear, so that we're not doing it in ways that people are just going to shut us down. And I think that's what really takes some refining to develop the capacity to do that.
It's an interesting question, and of course the answer is yes, we should absolutely be talking about this. And I think Will touched on that the question really is kind of how should we be talking about this? Because it's critical that we talk about it. You know, we need to be messengers in our own lives to our family, friends, our online community, however it is that you can influence is absolutely important. And I think it's, you know, food issues, it's really interesting how this is such a touchy subject. People are so, you know, they're so defensive about this. And I don't know, I often think of like, you know, a dog that's food possessive, and you know, you try to take their food away, and they're you know, we kind of have that as a society. You know, we don't want our three meals a day are very sacred to us, and we want our cheeseburgers, and we want our, you know, our cheese and milkshakes and omelets and all that. We don't want to have to think that that's, you know, causing suffering of animals and causing environmental degradation. People just don't want to hear it. But it's critical that they do. And so how do we get that information out? I think that something that's happened is that now vegans often are kind of like apologetic vegans now. You know, we feel like we have to be so careful and so sensitive, and oh, someone's gonna get upset, and you know, I don't want to rock the boat. Well, you know what, we've got to rock the boat to a point. And of course we want to be heard, so I don't mean to be mean or yelling or, you know, anything like that, but But these issues need to be brought up, and people need to be challenged on them. And and I think it's very important that we do speak up whenever we can and however we can, and kind of get out of our comfort zone a little, perhaps, and find the best ways to talk about this, because we've got to get the information out there. And don't be apologetic about it. I often say that the best way is to talk about your experience instead of saying you should do this. I'm vegan because it's very important to the animals, to the environment, whatever it is. We've got to find those ways that will be heard, but we've got to get the information out there. So
there are about 10 billion, give or take, land animals killed for food in this country each year. And during the roughly hour and a half that we're going to be talking, more than 1 million animals will be killed. Where are all these animals? You could go outside and look around. You're not going to see any of them. You definitely won't see any chickens or pigs. You might see some cows grazing somewhere. With roughly 313, 315 million people in this country, if you do the math, kind of rough, back of the napkin, about 30 animals per person killed for food each year in this country. And imagine if every omnivore had 30 animals traveling around with him or her all the time, like a cow, two pigs, and 27 chickens. That would really put this in perspective, seeing those animals. But we never see them. Why? Because 98 to 99% of them spend their lives in factory farms. There are 19,000 factory farms in this country, and that's where, statistically speaking, virtually all of our animal foods come from. It's important for us to not forget that that's the case, and to remember that simply because we can't see the animals that are being eaten doesn't mean that they're not spending their lives suffering. And that's what we're going to talk about during this panel, I think.
And also, I just want to add to that beautiful image you had, David. There's probably, besides those 30, how many, 30 or so animals, another 70 or maybe even more water animals that would be swimming around you as well. So we have a gigantic impact on animals, hundreds, thousands, directly. And this is basically, well, people, in a sense, don't want to be reminded of this, because I think that deep down we all have a good heart. One of the things that I just want to mention briefly, I think is very important, and maybe I'll mention it again later, is that to remind people that the only reason we're eating animal foods is because of the culture that we're born into, that we're born into communities where that's what people do. And I've talked about this all over the world, and I've never found anyone who disagreed with that. Even in the cornfields of Iowa, I remember talking and telling a bunch of ranchers, the only reason anyone eats meat and dairy is because of the families they're raised in, the communities they're raised in, and they said, yep, that's true. And so we're just basically following a script. It's kind of a tribal thing. It's like we're born into this tribe, and that's what the tribe eats. And as vegans, really, it's kind of a major leap to eat a different food, right? It's kind of like leaving the tribe. And I think a lot of people at a deep level are afraid to leave the tribe at a very sort of pre-conscious level. And so when we come along and we talk about the importance of being conscious about our food, they would rather be unconscious and be part of the tribe than to be conscious and sort of leave the tribe. And yet, leaving the tribe, we actually are part, we find we're part, that's why I'm glad Charlie Behrens mentioned the idea. We have the vegetarians of Central Florida, we have many other groups, we have many other online groups. We're creating alternative tribes, essentially, tribes based on sanity, compassion, sustainability, freedom, health, justice, and so forth. And that these tribes, these communities, really are the seed of the future. If we're going to have a future, these are the seed communities of the future, to be aware of the issues that we're talking about here in these panels. Thanks.
So let's start out talking about dairy cows that are raised to produce milk. It sounds not so bad. They just hang around, do their thing in the sun, and then every now and then you milk them to get milk. why is that such a big deal? You know, what's so bad about their life if they're not, you know, they're just getting milked every now and then? What's the big deal?
This is a huge one, and one that I think is interesting. You started with dairy cows, because most people, when you talk about animal foods, they think, well, I don't eat meat. You know, that's where the cruelty is, but dairy, you know, you're not hurting the animal at all. And in fact, I remember not too long ago, I was in Southern California, I was talking to a woman who was in her 60s. She had a PhD, very well educated, and we were talking a little bit about dairy. And she said, wait a minute, are you telling me that cows don't just give milk? And I said, no, they're like us. I mean, you know, cows don't just give milk. Like, women don't just start spouting milk out of their breasts, you know, for no reason. They cows are the same way. They don't just start spouting milk out of their udders because they're cows. They have to be impregnated. Then the cow, after she gives birth to a calf, then she is lactating, and that's for the calf. But we steal the calf, and then we steal the milk. And she said, I don't believe I never thought of that. And then I, you know, sort of like I realized that even well-educated people very often don't make the connection that cows aren't just given by God for us to us as milk machines, like vending machines that we just you know, feed them and they give us milk, that they are sentient beings who, in order to get milk from them, we have to harm them. We have to. We have to confine them. We have to impregnate them against their will. When they give birth to a baby, on any dairy, organic or not, that baby is always taken. It's not your baby, that's my baby. I own you and I own your baby, and I take the baby, and then I impregnate you again on what the industry calls a rape rack. And you know, I want to kind of disabuse us of the notion that somehow some, you know, that there's a way to do this in a way that's not violent. I know people who have a few cows, and they say, well, it's fine because, you know, we have the veterinarian comes and impregnates the cows, but the truth is, and they told me, I remember that the cows have learned what the veterinarian's truck sounds like, and as soon as they hear that truck come, they run. They want to get as far away as they possibly can from the sperm gun that's going to be shoved up inside them and fired. And so the actual process of impregnation of cows is violent. Every step of the way, it's violence. And I think we really have to understand that there's probably, and I would say you could make a very good case logically, that there's more suffering, actually, more sheer suffering in a glass of milk or in a piece of cheese than in a piece of flesh. Because in many ways, when we eat the flesh of animals, there's a lot of suffering. I mean, these poor animals are born into misery, they're horribly treated, and then they're killed in terror and pain. So there's enormous suffering, but they're killed, they die very young. You know, they're just, you know, a few weeks or a few months old before they're killed, typically. And even beef cows, you know, they're killed at the age of only about a year and a half. But dairy cows are kept alive longer, and so they're imprisoned. They're driven into extreme mental states of desperation for longer periods of time. They undergo having their babies stolen. Well, you can imagine if you're a woman, you're going through 9 months, like a dairy cow goes through 9 months of lactating and being pregnant, and then she gives birth to a baby. And everything, every cell in her being wants to love that baby, wants to protect the baby, wants to nurse the baby, and that is absolutely not allowed. That baby is stolen, and then she's put on the rape rack again and impregnated. And then while she's lactating, and you can again imagine if you're a woman, while she's lactating from this prior pregnancy, then she's impregnated again. So she's pregnant and lactating simultaneously, which no mammal is ever designed to do. That would never happen in the wild, ever. I mean, it wouldn't happen. So now she's being just sucked all her energy, and then as soon as she gives birth to that baby, she's impregnated again. So these animals go through five, even though they would live normally 20 to 25 to maybe 30 years, actually, in the wild, after 5 years, maybe four, maybe five, maybe six at the most, then they're sent to slaughter. And so they're killed, but they endure 5 years of intense suffering, giving birth to usually four times. And basically, if they give birth four times, three out of those four babies will be killed, either immediately because you know there's so many babies born on a dairy, again, organic or not, it doesn't matter, factory farm or not, it doesn't matter. They're killed because there's, if there's not a market for the veal, or if they can't be used to replace their mother as a slave on the dairy, they kill them either immediately or they kill them after a few months for veal, or they're sent off for beef production, but they will all be killed. And either immediately or a little later. And in fact, they build into the system very often that they impregnate the cow so that when she's sent off to slaughter the last time, she's got a baby inside of her that's 9 months, just ready to be born. So that when they kill, they get two for one. So when they kill the mother, then they open her up, and then they have a young calf inside ready to be born, and then they kill that calf too. Because that's worth a lot of money, because not only for calf skin, but also for rennet. In order to have cheese, you know, to coagulate the milk to make cheese, you need rennet, which comes from the lining of calves' stomachs. And this is one of the primary sources for rennet is killing calves before they're born, or killing calves right after they're born. And so on any dairy, organic or not, these babies are stolen. They're not given any milk from their mother. They're given a mixture of basically soy milk. It's so funny how the dairy industry slams soy milk, and yet they feed it to their own calves. And cow's blood also is mixed in there's so much blood they don't know what to do with it. But they found that there's nutrients in the blood, so they're drinking their own mother's blood. Maybe not their own mother, but cow's blood is part of the formula that they give. So it's very important, I think, to understand that there's built into this system not only a tremendous amount of violence, but also perversity. You know, there's enormous sexual perversity involved, like these sperm guns that they're always impregnating the females with. Where do they get the sperm? You know, they have to do perverse masturbation of male bulls to get the sperm that they're going to shove up the vaginas of cows to make these babies. So this dairy is very, very sexually violent and perverse. And it causes enormous suffering on every level, to the cows, to the calves. You're drinking suffering. You know, people talked about in the days when people thought about these things, they talked about how it was well known that a mother who was angry, very often her milk would somehow make her baby sick. Well, if you can think, if there was truth in that folk wisdom, that when we're drinking the milk of cows who are depressed and anxious and it's not even designed for us in the first place, but they've got all these hormones in their system based on stress and fear and pain of enormous. There's all kinds of pain that these poor cows go through. They're hooked up to electrical milking devices that are very rough on them, that shock them very often. They cause abrasions. Their extra teats are cut off. Their horns very often are cut off. There's a lot of mutilations that are going on. If you want to know what goes on in a dairy, look, for example, there's been quite a few undercover investigations. There's one called, for example, the Conklin, C-O-N-K-L-A-N, the Conklin Dairy. Just Google Conklin Dairy. This is a small dairy in Ohio, outside of Columbus, Ohio. They had a guy go in there, just a small family dairy with a hidden camera, and documented unbelievably, to me, just hideous violence against cows. It just literally punching, stabbing them with pitchforks, beating them, calves also. And the problem is, these situations bring out the worst in people. And anytime we've sent undercover investigators in on any situation, they've never come out and said, well, there wasn't any violence in there. They've always found hideous violence, even on small scale backyard operations, because the cows don't do what you want them to do. So you got to hit them, and then you got to hit them harder, and then pretty soon it just gets. It's not when people are looking, but that's what's going on behind the scenes. And so it's very important, I think, to understand that this is the situation. And then the final thing I'll say is I've spoken a lot to people, say, from India, right? And they say, well, you don't understand. You know, in India, the cow is part of the family. And, we just treat them well. You know, that's just how it is. That's how we did it for thousands of years. And I know people who have gone to India. Jains, I speak a lot for the Jains, and they've talked to people who are in these situations, you know, who have one or two cows, and they told me, they say, you just ask two questions. And this is the same, essentially, understanding. You ask them two questions, and they're very uncomfortable. One question you ask is, you say, well, what do you do with the male calves that are born? We send them off to market. That doesn't mean they go shopping. That means they get slaughtered. They send them off to market because you can't use them. You can maybe, a few of them, you can maybe castrate them and use them as oxen in the fields, but you don't need too many of those. So they send them, because they have to keep impregnating them. That's the problem. You have to impregnate them every 9 months so the milk keeps flowing every year. And then the other question you ask is, well, what do you do with the cows when their production declines? And it's, again, the same thing. They send them off to market, or they just let them go. And if you go to India, you'll find it's a tragedy, but cows are wandering the countryside starving. A lot of cows eating trash, barely surviving. So dairy is, there's a lot more I could say here, but I'm going to stop now because this entire panel could be talking about the abuse of dairy cows easily. It has layer upon layer upon layer of violence. And it all collects, I think, in milk. And we're feeding this to our children, you know, the violence of dairy to our kids. And I think it's very important to realize that there's another way of living that's not based on violence against the feminine, the mothers. If there's one thing we should protect and have mercy, it's mothers giving birth to babies. That's something we should not be abusing and violating.
Will spoke, I mean, absolutely beautifully and eloquently on this. It's all absolutely true. A couple of stories that I'll just tack on. One of the worst parts of the dairy industry is what Will was talking about, is the separation of the calves from the mothers. They want that milk for a product to sell, and the babies, it would be a waste to feed it to the babies, right? So they have to separate the babies. I said before, but I'll mention again, if this is the first time you've been hearing me, I live up in Sonoma County, California, which is about an hour north of San Francisco, and there is tons of dairy farming up there, all organic and local and supposedly groovy. I lived briefly in an area that there was a dairy just kind of over the hill from me. I mean, it's very close, kind of up the hill from me. And one night, it was in the evening, we heard this cow just bellowing and bellowing and bellowing. I mean, it was heart-wrenching. We were like, what are they doing to this cow? I mean, we thought that she was in some kind of horrible pain. We went up to see what was going on, and they had taken her calf away. And she was bellowing for her calf. It was heartbreaking, and it went on all night. So, you know, there's a great deal of emotion, emotional complexity to these animals. Another really interesting story is that on this one dairy, there was a cow who was put out to pasture, and this is actually kind of rare that a dairy cow actually goes out to pasture and then comes back in. A lot of them are just confined in feedlots and, you know, just really muddy, terrible pens. But she was able to go out to pasture, very rare, and would come back in for the milking, and she was dry. She had just given birth and should have had a full udder, but she kept coming back in dry, and the farmer couldn't figure it out. So he called a veterinarian to come and check her out and see if there was something medically wrong with her. She had given birth two or three times before and with no problems. The veterinarian checked her over, couldn't find anything physically wrong or the reason why her udder would be empty. So the farmer decided the next morning to follow her out to the field. And he followed her out, and on the edge of the field where there was brush and forest, she had a calf hidden. She had given birth to twins. And she knew that if she brought them both back to the farmer, that they would be taken from her. So she made a Sophie's choice and decided to bring one of them. I'm sorry, it kind of makes me a little choked up. It's really so sad. She brought one of the calves back to the farmer, knowing that that would satisfy him, and he would think she just gave birth to one, and she hid the other one in the forest so that she could come back to her calf daily and feed her and care for her. It's an incredible story of, it took courage, it took foresight. I mean, this is amazing emotional complexity. So, you know, there's a lot going on there. And just on that note, I want to mention that, you know, we've moved well beyond knowing on a scientific level that animals feel pain. I mean, we know that. We know they have a central nervous system, that they have the capacity to feel pain the same as we do. This has been, you know, absolutely scientifically proven. So what's happening now in science is that we're shifting to looking at sentience and consciousness and emotional complexity. You know, what's going on in these animals' brains? And there was an interesting collaboration amongst zoologists and biologists and neuroscientists that study animals' brains. They came together, they wrote what's called the Cambridge Declaration on Consciousness, and they you know, came to the conclusion that the data is just overwhelming, that animals have the same neurological substrates that generate consciousness as humans. They are just as consciously aware as we are. They are sentient beings with emotionally complex lives. So, you know, just an interesting insight into farmed animals' lives. But we'll move on from dairy. I know we've talked a lot about it.
And we're used to thinking about cows as being sort of dull and not a lot going on inside. But the research shows something very different, and that is that cows think, they have emotion, they can recall, they can get excited. In one study, they gave cows a problem to solve, and if they solved it, they could get a reward of some hay. And they measured their brain activity, and they found that they literally got excited when they solved the problem. In another study, they gave cows, and I'm simplifying this one a little bit, they gave them a choice to go outside in grass or inside to a building, and almost universally the cows want to go outside. It's not really a big surprise. All animals evolved in nature living outside, and we all want to be outside. But today in this country, a majority of dairy cows are raised in what are called zero grazing environments. It's a factory farm. They spend their entire life in a steel and concrete stall. They're not allowed to go outside. Now, every so often, somebody lives near a local or an organic farm like Hope, and they'll see some dairy cows. And yes, there are some of those out there, but statistically, that's not the majority. Majority of cows are raised in factory farms. And as a result of living in those conditions, getting very little exercise, spending a lot of time standing in their own urine or excrement, they develop painful conditions like lameness. Statistically speaking, 100% of dairy cows in zero grazing will at some point in their life become lame. So that is the reality for dairy cows in factory farms.
Actually, I'd like to just say one other thing about, those are really good points. There is also, though, this, again, illusion that somehow cows on organic operations have it better off. And in some ways that may be true, in some ways it's actually not true. And besides the fact that there are lots of loopholes built into the organic regulations that allow farmers to have animals that are basically 100% of the time inside, and they can still call it organic if somehow the sunlight shines through or something or other. But something that organic does require is that they not be given any antibiotics. And so, for example, cows on standard operations, when they get mastitis, and mastitis is the inflammation of the udder. So, and this is something that is rampant throughout dairy industries, both organic and non-organic, there's mastitis. And because the cows are kept in unnatural situations in all these cases. And so on a standard dairy, they're given antibiotics to treat the situation. Mastitis is a painful condition for cows because when they get this infection in their udders, the teats clog up and they can't get, the milk doesn't come out. So it's bad for the dairy farmer and it's bad for the cow. And so they give them antibiotics to kill off the infection. But on organic dairies, they're not allowed to give them any antibiotics. So what do they do to get around that? They have, they've developed instruments, tools, which like one of them is like this, it's like a corkscrew, but it's thinner and longer, and they just twist it up to her teats, and then they rip it down. And so this is an extremely painful procedure, obviously, for the cow. And it usually only lasts for a short period of time, and then the infection comes back, and then they got to do it again. And so being a cow in an organic dairy can actually be much more abusive, more cruelty involved. They're not able to give some other drugs that help relieve some of the other sufferings they get with skin diseases and other things too. So I think it's very important to realize that there's no way to have dairy products or any animal food for that matter that does not cause suffering to these animals. They're kept, they have to be used, and they're pushed to give to give more than they normally would.
Yeah, I'd like to just tack on to that because, again, and I said this before about my book, when I was researching for my book, I thought that I was going to have to again and again say, well, you know, of course it's a little better, it's better, but going plant-based is best. Again and again, I found that both environmentally and ethically, these labels can be worse. Just like Will was saying with organic dairy, it's a great example. I interviewed large animal veterinarians that work on farms in my area, and I had a veterinarian confide in me that some of the cows that were in the worst pain, that had the most severe cases of mastitis, were on organic dairies, and that they didn't do anything about it because, of course, if they took them out of production and gave them medications, they couldn't sell the milk. So they wanted to continue selling that milk, so the cows didn't, they went untreated, they stayed sick, they stayed in pain. He said that some of the cows he saw in the worst conditions were on organic dairy farms. So, like Will said, in these instances, these labels can actually be even worse.
So if someone says, you know what, I don't like factory farms, I agree, and I'm a vegetarian, I eat eggs because that doesn't really have anything to do with factory farms, would that be accurate?
No. No, chickens, unfortunately, chickens have just as much of a horrifying story that we have for the dairy cows, for chicken meat and for eggs. So there's two genetic strands of chickens now. I mean, that we have, genetically manipulated to be used for our chicken agribusiness. One are egg-laying strands of chickens, and the other are what are called broiler chickens, and those are the ones that are raised for meat. So both chickens, both the egg layers and the broiler chickens, are kept in just absolutely terrible conditions in the egg industry. They are often in what are called battery cages, which are these tiny, tiny cages just crammed in there, unable to even spread their wings. They're so close together. If you can imagine being in a crowded elevator, and it's so tightly confined that you're actually touching the other people in the elevator. You know how uncomfortable that feels, and you just like can't wait to get to the next level. Oh, that's their whole life. That's all the space they're given to live, their entire life. So the egg-laying hens are just in horrible conditions, de-beaked, all kinds of manipulations to their bodies that are very painful. The beak is a very sensitive part of the body, and they with a hot solder blade cut off the beaks when they're chicks. Debeaking in both industries, the egg laying and the raising for meat, in the broiler industry, for the broiler chickens. They're in these just windowless warehouses with thousands of birds on the floor, crowded in there, ammonia, the waste, they're just living in their muck and waste. The ammonia can burn their sensitive nostrils, their eyes, their throats, can get very infected and painful from all the ammonia in these terrible, very confined areas with no ventilation, you know, and it's just so monotonous. You know, if you think of the chickens' ancestors were the wild fowl in like Southeast Asia that lived in the jungles and would climb up or fly up to the trees to roost, and there's so much stimulation in nature. You've got color and bugs and sunlight. They love to bask in the sun, and they love to dust bathe. And there's just so much life for a natural chicken. And in these places, it's just, there's nothing. All of those natural instincts and conditions completely denied. They are, you know, it's just gray monotony. There's nothing, no stimulation. It drives them insane, and it's just really hard to imagine how miserable, just really how miserable their lives are. You know, and another aspect to all this is the hatcheries. So no egg industry, no matter the label, all these small scale, cage-free, free-range, all of this, no matter the label, no egg production can profitably hatch their own chicks. So they're always sourcing their chicks through the mail from hatcheries. And these hatcheries are just brutal, brutal places. They, you know, a chicken, of course, the natural way to hatch is in a warm, safe nest with a mother hen. And do you know, it's really amazing, even when the chicks are still in the eggs, the mother hen and chicks are communicating. They're cooing and clucking and communicating to each other. You know, the little chicks are saying, "Oh, I'm cold. I need to be turned." There's this amazing, beautiful mothering. I mean, we hear about, you know, a doting mother is often called a mother hen. Well, that's because naturally, chickens are incredible mothers. This is all completely denied in any egg industry, no matter the label. No chick is, you know, hatched in a warm nest with a loving mother. No, they're hatched in these industrial hatcheries in metal drawers where they're immediately thrust onto conveyor belts and metal machinery and have the workers, you know, tossing them about like canned goods. It's horrible. For my book, I interviewed a gentleman who had worked in one of these hatcheries. And he said, what he told me was horrifying, that they there's all these horrible injuries that happen to the chicks in the metal machinery where they get their wings caught or their legs caught, and you know, and their wing is ripped off, or they're, you know, they get a big laceration and they're just in pain, and they'll just throw them on the floor for the day to just suffer until the end of the day when they sweep them up and throw them outside still alive and suffering. I mean, it's just brutal, brutal places, these hatcheries. So they have the issue of horrifying conditions coming into the world. And then even in the cage-free and free-range industries, it's really not any better. So a cage-free operation for an egg-laying facility can be the same as for a broiler, the way they raise the broilers for the meat. It's the same, basically, just these windowless warehouses, thousands of birds on the floor, they're still de-beaked, they're still overcrowded, they're still, you know, dust and ammonia and all the stuff they're breathing, it's horrible. So, and for free range, and the only thing a producer has to do, and these labels are just, I'm going to talk more about this tomorrow in my presentation if you're going to be around at 11 o'clock about all these labels, but I'll just say briefly that there's so little regulation on these labels. In fact, with cage-free, free-range, all these ones we're talking about, there's basically zero regulation. All a farmer has to do is fill out a form, send it in to the regulating body, whether it be the USDA or the FDA, And you know, no one gets denied these labels. No one comes and inspects the farm. They can say whatever they want. For free range, the only regulation is that they have to have access to the outside, which could be in one of these big windowless warehouses. They just open the doors to a little, maybe, you know, 5 foot by 5 foot concrete patio that's so unappealing no bird would even want to go out there, and they can call that free range. So, again, there's very little regulation, and I'll just wrap it up with the end of their life, which is always cut very short. A chicken can live up to 15 years, but the broiler chickens that are raised for their meat, they actually have them so genetically manipulated that they are pumped up and fully grown at about 5 weeks. They're slaughtered in a fraction of their lifespan. They live 5 weeks. That's it. It's all the life they get. An egg-laying hen, you know, maybe a year or two, her egg production will start to decline because of the intensive conditions, and they have so many other little chicks coming in that it's just more profitable to bring in more hens. They'll clear out a whole egg-laying barn in a couple of years, so they get maybe 2 or 3 years of life, that's it, and they all go to slaughter. Egg-laying hens go to slaughter for low-quality chicken products like chicken pot pie or chicken ground chicken, things like that. So egg-laying hens are absolutely eaten and are going to into the meat production. So, you know, it, again, it's... and the slaughtering process is brutal. Chickens actually are exempt from the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act. This is one of the very few regulations that we have for animals in the food industry. We have very few regulations, but this is one of them, and that it states that an animal must be rendered unconscious before it is slaughtered, he or she is slaughtered, excuse me. So, you know, but this applies to very few animals that are actually slaughtered. Poultry is exempt, as well as fish and rabbits are exempt from this law, so it only really applies to cows, pigs, and sheep. Chickens are 97% of the animals that are land animals that are slaughtered. 97%. So 97% of the animals that we're slaughtering are exempt from this Humane Methods of Slaughter Act, and it's really, it's so brutal. There's, of course, the transportation, too. There's so many aspects to it that are horrible. I know I've been talking for a while, so I'll try to wrap it up. But with the slaughter, you know, the workers take them roughly by the legs, hang them upside down in shackles. They go through this conveyor that's, you know, attached to a conveyor belt. They go through the process, and there is an electrified stunning that happens, but this isn't rendering them, you know, from feeling the pain. It's not that kind of stunning. It's actually just a paralysis. It paralyzes them so that their feathers come out more easily, but they are still feeling everything. And they go have their throats slit. It can take minutes to die as they're kicking and struggling. You know, throat cutting is not a quick or painless way to die. There's many veterinarian organizations that have stated that throat cutting is very painful, that it is not the way we should be killing animals. But there's no humane way to kill these animals. We can't kid ourselves that, you know, and try and hide from the violence that is killing these animals. So chickens have it just as bad as the dairy cows, as you can kind of gather. So I guess I'll end with that, and let's see if Will has or Dave has something to add about chickens.
I'll add something briefly. Notwithstanding that chickens are exempt from the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act, you might think, well, states have anti-cruelty laws. Wouldn't those apply to these sorts of practices? Well, the answer is no, because chickens are exempt from those too. All farm animals are exempt from state anti-cruelty protections in this country. So, for example, male chicks are completely irrelevant in the egg-laying production process because, first of all, they don't lay eggs, and second of all, they're not genetically engineered to grow to produce meat, so they're simply killed in any way that is expedient. any male chicks can be killed in any way whatsoever. They can be left to starve to death. They can be left to freeze to death. They can be put in hefty garbage bags, tied down. And it's all completely legal. Things that if you did to a dog or a cat, you'd be prosecuted potentially for a felony. In fact, in one case in San Diego a few years ago, live chickens were thrown into a wood chipper because they were they had finished their laying years, they were no longer productive, and there wasn't really any expedient way to get rid of them, so they just threw them into the wood chipper. And the district attorney refused to prosecute because there was no intent. They weren't trying to be cruel, they were just doing something that was expedient and was part of business. So that's how farm animals in general get treated, and that's how chickens in particular get treated. And they have somewhere between no legal protection and very, very little legal protection.
Yeah, just briefly, I'll just add, I think it's really a wonderful thing if you ever have a chance to go to a sanctuary where you can actually meet chickens and turkeys and pigs and cows and other animals and see them as intelligent individuals, sentient beings with personalities, and get to see how inquisitive they are, how affectionate they are, and that they are not just objects that just objects, just things, but they're actually beings. There's someone in there, and for me, it's been great. I've been able to go to probably 30 or 40 sanctuaries over the years. I've been traveling all over North America and internationally, and I never failed to be struck by the beauty of these animals, actually. And I think this is one of the great education efforts we can mount in our society. Besides, I think it's important to be aware of egregious abuse of these animals, but also to take into account the fact that as we have so many stories about our pet dogs and cats and other animals that are companion animals and how we would never want to do this to them, one of the great things that's actually happening is we have sanctuaries, and the other thing we're having more of too, which I think is helpful, are YouTube videos, right? YouTube videos of cows listening to these people playing music to them and running over and listening, you know, YouTube videos of chickens running around and being friendly and relating. And, you know, I think YouTube in general can be a fabulous tool to help us maybe get outside of some of the cultural stereotypes. And then the final thing I'll just say on this too, I think these are all very important, but again, to come back to this idea that local, small-scale agriculture is not necessarily cruelty-free. I remember, for example, reading about an undercover study, investigation that was done in England outside of Devon, which is kind of a new age or kind of very progressive area in England, where most people don't want to buy factory farm meat. You know, they want to buy local, organic, free range, and that kind of thing. And somebody went into the local slaughterhouse, you know, because we know these big slaughterhouses are hideous, terrible. The line speeds are so fast. The poor animals, sometimes they get, you know, they end up boiling alive and all these other things. But they discovered in this investigation that the small-scale local slaughterhouse that was being used for these animals, chickens and cows and pigs, was the abuse, actually the deliberate cruelty to the animals was much higher. That the that this kind of situation tended to attract sadistic people, or people would make people that way, and they would begin to really not just kill the animals, but really make them suffer before they kill them. And so again, when we go to Whole Foods, or I don't want to pick on Whole Foods, but any time we think we're getting something that's organic or something that's better that way, to realize that this system brings out the worst in people. And there's been studies done, for example, people think the Amish must be so great. And I mean, studies of the Amish treatment of animals are, you know, they're very, very violent and brutal to their animals. And so, again, we have to realize that this is a system that thrives on, it's based on violence, and these animals are seen as things. They're not considered legal persons, right? They have no rights at all. They're just an object. It's like, you know, it's like this cup. I can crush this cup and no one's going to take me to court about it, right? I can do the same thing to a chicken. I can crush a chicken just like that, and it's a thing.
It is a thing. It is seen as a thing. It's a property. I can own it as property. So we realize this is what animal agriculture societies do. And so we have to, again, awaken out of this trance that brings out the worst in us.
So is the solution, if you don't want to mistreat animals based on what you're saying, is the solution then to eat fish? Is the solution, if you don't want to mistreat animals, is the solution to eat fish?
I'd say no. It's really interesting. There has been an incredible amount of science done in the last, 10, 20 years on fish. And whether they feel pain, whether they're conscious, all of these kinds of things. And what we're learning is it's really amazing. We have absolutely scientifically proven, just like land animals, fish do suffer. They do feel pain when they are exposed to something painful. They will rub the area. They will avoid painful stimuli. So their behavior suggests that they absolutely do feel pain. And the way we kill these billions of fish is really brutal. Taking them out of the water, the suffocation that it's just like us drowning. It's a very violent, frightening, awful death. And sometimes they are just cut up alive and conscious. There was an undercover investigation that Mercy for Animals did on a catfish production. And these catfish were, just on the ice, and they were still conscious, and they were being cut up alive, and you could see the fish writhing. They're feeling that. It's brutal the way we kill fish, absolutely. And another aspect that we're learning through science is that fish are actually much more intelligent than we give them credit for. Much more going on there than we previously thought. They have absolutely emotional capacity. They have long-term memory. There's kind of this myth like that goldfish can only remember 3 minutes or whatever. Absolutely untrue. They've done studies where there were fish that were when they flipped a switch or pushed a lever or something like that, only a certain time of day they got the food, and so they wouldn't hit the lever until it was that time of day. Like they learned that it was that a certain time of day that they hit the lever and they get the food. So then they'd stop hitting the lever until it was that time of day. Then they'd take the fish out of that situation for up to a year, put them back, and they remembered. So, they have a lot more intelligence than we give them credit for. And we are just brutally slaughtering them by the millions and causing an ecological crisis in our oceans with overfishing.
Yeah, and I'll just say, again, I have a real thing for fish. But I think, we talk about how terrible animal agriculture is or factory farming is to land animals. Aquaculture, or the factory farming basically of water animals, takes that to a whole other level in terms of cruelty. And I've seen these places. There's two kinds of aquaculture. Some are offshore, some are like big swimming pools. And I remember looking into these, and it's just black water. I thought there was nothing in there except black water. I didn't think there was anything in there. And then as I kept looking, I realized that this black water was actually packed with fish. There were so many fish in there, they could hardly move, and they were just kind of just packed in there, and they could hardly, like I say, swim. And they were swimming in their own feces. That's why the water was black, and there were workers dumping in different kinds of chemicals and antibiotics to keep them alive. And so this kind of suffering to these animals, and very often if they're, for example, salmon, if they're being factory farmed in offshore pens, there's sea lice, which normally in the wild are not a problem for salmon because the salmon are swimming. But when they can't get away, they're surrounded by huge clouds of sea lice, which actually eat them from the outside in. And it's, again, enormously painful for these poor salmon. They can't escape, and they're getting eaten. So, of course, the workers don't want that to happen. So they're, again, dumping in all kinds of chemicals and pesticides to try to kill the sea lice. which are also not only attacking the salmon, but any other fish that happen to be swimming by the area get also attacked by sea lice. And so we're finding that the aquaculture operations are not only extremely cruel to the fish. I mean, you think about the cruelty to these poor animals. They're factory farming tuna fish now. I mean, tuna fish are animals that celebrate their lives swimming up to 40 or 50 miles an hour, covering literally hundreds or thousands of miles, and they're spending their entire life in a metal cage. And people are eating this, being told they're getting their healthy omega-3s. You know, I mean, the extent of the cruelty, the abuse, and the toxins that concentrate, it boggles the mind. And as Hope said, I think it's very important to remember that the scientific evidence is that fish have intelligence at the level of non-human primates. They're completely sentient. And they're by far, I think, they suffer the most. I mean, there's many more water animals being killed in a variety of ways. Octopuses and other animals. These are all animals with a tremendous intelligence. So I think it's really, when we move to a more compassionate diet, I think it's important to remember that doesn't include fish. People, you know, have this idea that they're cold-blooded or something, so they don't feel. And I think that's a huge mistake to make. And it's kind of too bad also to see so many communities having fishing derbies and teaching kids how to fish and having the grandparents come down and show them the joys of fishing. And, you know, and I see this happens in communities everywhere. And there's this complete disconnection that what I'm actually teaching my grandson or granddaughters, a lot of times little girls too, when they're in their fishing, to completely disconnect from any natural sense of caring or kindness for another living being and just play the animal on the line. And the other thing they've discovered too, which I think is important to remember, that when we're doing just fishing where we throw the fish back, very often they die. I mean, it depends on the species and a lot of other statistics. I talk about it in the World Peace Diet, but essentially this playing of animals, fishing without eating them, Obviously, is extremely traumatic to these animals and very often kills them. So we have a long way to go in our treatment of animals on this planet, of fish.
And I'll just expand a little bit on what Will said, which is that fish feel. Historically, there's this conventional wisdom that fish and crustaceans don't feel pain, perhaps because they don't vocalize. You never hear a fish screaming. You never hear a crab or a shrimp or a lobster screaming, but they just lack vocal cords. But plenty of research has been done that show that fish and crustaceans do, in fact, feel pain. And while I'm not a fan of intentionally torturing animals to see if they feel pain, I think the research is interesting, and I just want to tell you about it for a second. Trout had bee venom injected in their face, and as a result, they engaged in aversive behavior, and they engaged in behavior that indicated they were in pain. They rocked back and forth. They tried to rub their face against the side of their enclosure. And later, when they were injected with morphine, which reversed or temporarily eliminated the pain effects, they stopped those behaviors. So the trout feel pain. Prawns, in one study, had stinging chemicals applied to their antennae, and they exhibited similar aversive behavior to get away from those chemicals. In another study, crabs were subjected to electric shocks, and they also showed aversive behavior. So to the extent that there ever was an idea that fish, crustaceans, or other animals don't feel pain, we now know that that's simply nonsense and that they do suffer. And that, for example, when fish are eviscerated and left to die, they can suffer for 20 or 30 minutes as they die slowly.
Another animal, pigs seem very happy. They roll in the mud, they eat a lot of food. Are pigs treated okay?
I mean, as far as pigs go, and really I think you could extend this to all the animals, other animals, sheep and lambs and other animals, they're treated as units. You can just watch undercover videos of the shameful, I think to our society, the abuse of these animals. There's something called packing them. If they're not at the right weight for example, in farm operations, they'll pack them. PAC, it's an acronym for pound against concrete. So they'll just take the small pigs that are too small, and they'll pick them up by their hind feet, and they'll just pound them against the concrete to kill them.
Sometimes called thumping. It's an industry term.
And the interesting thing, people really complained about that and made a kind of a big stink about it. And so in order to try to save face, the pig industry decided they wouldn't do that anymore. But they couldn't find anything else that was less cruel and violent than that. So they've gone back to that again. They tried other things, but no matter how to kill it, killing an animal because you just want to kill them is violent, and there's really no way around that. And so these animals, again, suffer just from hyper-confinement. They're hyper-confined. They can't turn around. They suffer from being impregnated over and over again, and then their deaths are extremely painful. Maybe the only time they ever see fresh air is the time when they're on the truck going to the slaughterhouse. Very often they're shipped in extreme heat or extreme cold. I kind of hate to say all this stuff. It's like such a bummer to hear all this. You know, it's like, who wants to hear all this? But it's true. I mean, the fact is that, like, in freezing weather, these animals will literally stick to the sides of the trucks, and the workers will just pull them off, and sometimes they'll leave a leg, you know, attached to the truck or whatever. It's just they're not seen as beings; they're seen as meat already before they're even killed. So, when you have a situation with in a modern industrial operation that's based on minimizing costs, the animals really suffer in ways we can't even imagine.
And finally, how are cows treated? Not dairy cows, just cows for meat. How are they treated?
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's interesting because most people, when they're cutting back on meat and they're wanting to make change, they'll cut out beef first or red meat first. Well, cows kind of arguably have it the best, really. I mean, it's still horrible. All these things that we're talking about, you know, can occur to cows. But cows that are raised for beef, I mean, they still are dehorned, castrated without anesthesia. There's still horrible manipulations that happen to them as well. But, you know, they go to slaughter at a very young age. They don't have, though, all the horrible things that we have talked about with the dairy and egg industry. It's interesting, there's a quote from Ingrid Newkirk of PETA. I'm not, I don't love PETA, I don't hate PETA, I'll just say that. but anyway, I love Ingrid Newkirk's quote, and that is that if you want to cut out animal products in the order that the animals suffer most, you should cut out dairy and eggs first. And that's very rarely how people do it. They'll go from red meat to chicken to dairy and cat. So, I mean, it's arguably, of course, these cows are still treated horribly, brutally slaughtered. A lot of the things we were talking about still occur with cows. But yeah.
I guess let me wrap up then with a final question. I guess my final question is, do you eat animal products, and why not if you don't?
I don't eat animal products, and the way that I like to think about it is that because we know that virtually all the animals raised for food in this country, 98 to 99% of them, come from factory farms, and because we know that those conditions in factory farms are miserable for those animals, we know that the animals spend their entire lives in conditions of suffering and misery, and then they die a violent death. And if anyone's been at this conference for the past several days, they've heard a lot of doctors and dietitians talk about the fact that you don't actually need animal products as part of your diet, and if anything, you should avoid animal products. I don't need to eat animals, and in fact, when I engage in discussions with people like my brother, for example, who likes to eat animal products, if I offer him some vegan lasagna, he'll say, that's really good. You know, it's got like vegan sausage, vegan cheese, it's all organic. He'll say, that's really good. That's like a 9 out of 10. And the only thing that would make that a 10 out of 10 is if it had real cheese and real sausage in it. Now, when I hear that, what I'm hearing is somebody saying, in order for me to be really amused for the 3 or 4 minutes that it takes me to eat my meal, an animal has to spend his or her life suffering in misery and then die a violent death. Otherwise, I'm not adequately amused. And so that's why I don't eat animal products.
So I always say the best decision I ever made in my life, besides marrying my wonderful wife, Madeline, is going vegan 35 years ago. And the underlying reason for me doing it then is really the same now, is I just can't tolerate the idea of contributing to the suffering of these animals. And it's very interesting, I think, when you look at this whole range of the scale, right? We have, on one side of the scale, we have what we've talked about at this panel, which is kind of painful to talk about, the sheer abuse of animals. We have the environmental devastation, we have the health problems, we have the cultural devastation and war and all of that that's connected with animal agriculture. And then on the other side we have, I just like how sausage tastes. And you know, how do you equalize? You can't equalize that. But we can, I think, begin to awaken to the fact that we're engaging in robotic behavior if we're eating animal foods. We're sort of programmed into something at a very deep level that is very difficult to question. And so I think the most important thing in all of this is, from my point of view anyway, is not to cultivate a hatred or even anger at the industries that are engaged in these behaviors, or the individuals, even if there are people we know who are taking out their wallets and voting for it and paying for it. It's really to understand that this is a system that has been going for 8 or 10,000 years. We're born into it, and the underlying insanity of it, in the sense of the sense that we all have, I think, that it's not only unsustainable, but it really is a manifestation of a sense of fundamental disconnectedness from what we're doing, and that we can actually make a huge difference in the lives, not only of animals and wildlife, but really in the life of our culture, that our culture can no longer continue on this path of shutting down our awareness, of going unconscious, of looking at beings merely as objects to be used. And it's going to be seen more and more as something that's absolutely intolerable. And I think this is really the good news. You know, for example, with secondhand smoke, remember secondhand smoke? Before secondhand smoke, remember there was, people smoked, right? And people smoked because they wanted to, right? It was a personal choice. I like to smoke. And I remember when I was a kid in the 50s, doctors recommended it. You know, if you're stressed out, just have a cigarette. I smoke a Camel. You have these Camel ads for doctors. And then secondhand smoke was discovered, and now it's a whole different thing, because if you're smoking, it's a choice for yourself, but you're harming others. You're harming kids or other people who are in the same space. And then they discovered third-hand smoke, which is, you know, even if you go into a room where someone smoked, it's the drapes are exuding this toxic chemicals from this person who was in there smoking. So it's been banned. And the amount of smoking has really decreased, especially in the United States, because of this. And it's and so the corporations are going to other countries. They're going to Africa and Asia and other ways to try to sell their wares. But this really has become much more conscious. We've been much more consciously aware of it. And so I think what we're seeing in our society is a similar movement with meat and dairy and eggs, that it's not a personal choice. People have wanted to say, it's a personal choice. I just want to do it. But it's not, you're harming, I mean, like I said, you're harming, you know, ecosystems, water supplies, global warming, the insurance rates of everybody go higher because you want to eat meat. You know, I have to pay for that. I have to pay for your heart disease and your obesity and your diabetes. We have to pay for that in lost production. And the poor animals pay the ultimate price. And, you know, you would never find someone raping someone and saying, well, man, that felt good. That gives me reason. I really enjoyed it. It was good. You know, it's like, no, you go to jail. So we're getting to the point now where we're, I think, getting to the realization that these beings' interests are as important to them as our interests are to us, and we have absolutely no ethical or any other level where we can justify cruelly abusing them merely for tradition or for taste or for any other reason, that they have the right to live their lives. And this is the great liberation that is coming for us, I think, as human beings. Good. Thank you.
So I've been vegan for 25 years, and my reasons, you know, it's what we've been talking about for the last 3 hours. For the animals, I actually went vegan initially for the environmental reasons. I was an environmental activist, and then slowly I shifted, the animals kind of called me to them, the farmed animals, and I shifted my focus to the ethical issues. But you know, I'd really just like to end on kind of a positive note, in that you know, I've seen such amazing progress, so much wonderful change in the last 25 years since I've been in this. You know, 25 years ago when I went vegan, you had to want it. You really had to want it. You know. There wasn't, the only soy milk I could find was powdered soy milk, and you added it to water, and it was chalky and nasty, and you know, if you wanted a cookie, you had to bake it. I mean, there was nothing. And it's really amazing now, the abundance of vegan food comparatively. I mean, now there's, you know, we just went to the Whole Foods here in Orlando, and there's more vegan food at this Whole Foods in Orlando than there is in the one in California I go to. There was a vegan jelly donut. I was like, really? You know, so it's amazing how far we have come. And I think that, you know, as really ultimately, this is a justice issue, a social justice issue for these animals. And when you compare to other justice issues, the civil rights issue, child labor, anything like that, we've come so far in just a really short amount of time. We're on a great trajectory, a great momentum, so we just have to really keep it up. One thing that I think is important to recognize is we have so many people that go vegan, but a lot of them slide back, and a lot of them go back to eating animal products. And you know, when polled, if we can you know, believe these studies, I think that it's true, a lot of the reasons are social, and you know, social pressures and convenience, and not being able to find the vegan food. So I really encourage everyone to, you know, to create society, a vegan society, create you know, places that we go to gather, the potlucks and events and things where we can connect and feel supported, like you feel that you are in community. Because often when we go vegan, we make these discoveries and we're telling our family and friends, and we think, you know, of course they're gonna be just as amazed and horrified as me. And they're not, you know, and you're kind of like, oh, and you start feeling very alone. So it's important that we connect as vegans and find our new family and our new friends and feel supported and really find your way that you can reach out, that you can be a part of making this information available, whether that be talking to family and friends or possibly online or maybe some other way with your local vegetarian or vegan organization. Feel connected, because that's where we're gonna keep it going, keep it strong, and really gain the numbers. I know it's a lot. We just heard so much intense information, and it is heart-wrenching, and it is angering and frustrating and all of that, but help, you know, try to have that, go through those stages, but transform it into empowerment, transform it into action, and really help and go forth and find your niche where you can make a difference for these animals. You're now their voice. And we can do this. We really can. I believe very strongly that in just a few generations, it is absolutely possible that we could have a vegan world, a vegan society. If you go back 200 years, I'm actually not good with hundreds of years, but a few hundred years, and asked people, do you ever think that that slavery will be eradicated? Well, I think we can treat them better. Sure, we can treat them better, but I don't know. It's just so ingrained in the society. You know, it's so part of our economics. I don't think it'll ever really, be eradicated. Maybe we can change it. Maybe we can make it better. But I don't think we could ever really, eradicate society. And of course, I'm saying you would ask white people at that time. And so now, fast forward just a few hundred years and see how radically our society has shifted our views on that. You ask anyone about slavery, and at least in the U.S., and of course there is still a subculture of illegal slavery, I don't want to diminish that, but as a larger society, we have shifted those views. No, my gosh, we could never own another human being. How awful, how terrible. That was a blight on our history. This can happen. This can happen for animals. My husband, who's a co-author on my book, I'll just finish with this. He has a beautiful vision that he said at one point. He said, I see in the future a father talking to his son, and the son saying, well, why do we call this chicken? Why is it called chicken? And the father says, well, it used to actually be made out of chickens and not plants. It used to actually kill the chickens and eat them. And the child is horrified. He says, what? What? How can this be? This is the world we want to create, and we can. So thank you.